I don't worry about trying to unplug that for the video. I'll just turn it on.
It would be better if you
had
the sound of the
down, you should see an eye, five eyes. Five eyes are on this.
And the comments will be right.
Right.
Leet and GMC are here to help. You can shop online with Shop Click Drive, and you may even be able to schedule your certified.
This is not sponsored by GMC. I wish.
Yeah.
Wish GMC would sponsor this. We could build a set or something at that point, but we're just doing this for fun. Good evening, everyone. Pleasant View Baptist Church friends and family, and Salem Baptist Church friends and family. Got folks watching from not just our church, but also Salem Baptist Church this evening. Joined tonight alongside me is Jerry Brewer, pastor of Salem Baptist Church. Glad he's joining us again and might be with us for the foreseeable future. Is that right?
Yes, hope so.
His church is doing drive-in or drive-through services,
whatever you call it.
If you go by it. Moving, it's a drive-through.
Right.
Otherwise,
stop. It's driving.
Very good. You can place your orders, I guess.
Yes. It's all solid stuff. Hopefully.
Very good. He's at Morton's Gap, obviously. So if you're in the area, check him out Sunday morning, 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock.
Ten right o'clock. Now. They're starting early, an hour early, to because it's kind of hot now. So
right.
If you're in the area, join him 10 o'clock for worship service there at Morton's Gap, Salem Baptist Church. And he'll be with us Wednesday nights until something changes or they decide to go back in the building for
Correct.
The services. So he's joining us, keeping the crowds here kind of low at the house. It's just my family and Jerry stops in. Sometimes his daughter comes along with him, but otherwise, just very intimate crowd here. Gospel of Matthew tonight, chapter number 6. If you're in your books, it's lesson number 8, page number 25. Page 25, lesson number 8, and this will be in Matthew chapter number 6. Going to try to cover all the chapter tonight. I think we could get through it. We'll go at a pretty steady pace through this tonight. And then next week will be, Lord willing, chapter 7 of the Gospel of Matthew. And then after that, we'll be out of the teaching. We'll be past the Sermon on the Mount and into more action stuff. Less teaching, more doing. And I like that. To me, it's just more fun, those stories. But I appreciate Brother Brewer with me tonight. Anything you want to say to your folks?
It's good to see everybody at both churches. And just tune in and enjoy our study together as we grow in our faith. I appreciate you having me over.
Well, you're welcome. We have Ray Michael watching here. We have Elizabeth Rhodes, Jerry Brewer, of course, Jason Duncan, Sean Paul Thurby, Wilma Louise Leach, Sherry Corbin, a lot of folks who jumped in here tonight, so we're going to get started here. If you're scrolling through Facebook, stop, give us a minute or two. Hopefully we're going to feed you tonight. Let's jump, and if you'd like a copy of this study, a paper copy, email me, text me. I'll be glad to mail it to you, drop it off to your house if you live here locally. Otherwise, if you just want to get to your computer, go to Pleasant View Baptist Church Facebook page. There's a link, and you can just print that off. It's yours. It doesn't cost you a dime to get that. Or if you want to watch this after the fact, you may have some volume there. You might have to just go a little bit lower. We'll get a little feedback. Go to my YouTube channel afterwards, and you can watch it, or I'll post on Jerry's page also, Jerry Brewer. So without delay, let's jump in the text. Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Jesus says, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven.
Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have their reward. They have received their reward."
Very good. And I'll pause just for a second here. I want to show you in the text tonight that both believers and unbelievers have rewards for good works. And there's a difference on where those rewards take place. For the unbeliever, the reward is in this life only. For the believer, their treasures, the reward is for another life. So we should not do good works just for this life only. In fact, we ought not do good works for this life only, right? It's for the kingdom to come for sure. So I want you to notice that Christ didn't say that unbelievers don't get rewards. They just get them in this life. And I want to make a comment as we move on here tonight. It says in verse 2, it says, "When you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others." So you could say the Pharisees were blowing their own horn.
Yeah.
Is that right?
You could say that.
When they would do a showy deed of service, they would blow their horn and draw attention to themselves. So they're blowing their own horn. Maybe that's where that came from.
It might. It might have been.
Now, draw your attention here to the last part of verse 2. It says, "Truly I say to you, they have received the reward." So what is the reward of the Pharisee who does works, showy works, or the unbeliever who does showy works, maybe?
The praise of the people. I understand it to be the...
Yeah, and that's right. Immediate context would be because people saw them, right? There might be folks, and I'm not going to say that I know that it happens, that give at the end of the year for tax break purposes, right? I've got extra cash. I'll funnel this to the church. Mm. Again, should not be the motive for giving, just to get a tax break. I've never had enough money to be able to do that, to get a break. But so there's a lot of reasons that folks might want to do good. But I think the old pat on the back, people to praise you, is probably the reason we're getting here tonight. But they have their reward. And this goes for Christians too, right?
If
you're a Christian, you've done a good deed, so it can be noticed by your friends, the church, the community. If you've done it for that reason, you just got your reward.
Right. And there's always lurking, I think, in the heart of all of God's people, the desire to be noticed or to be told that was really good and to have that encouragement. And encouragement is fine, but I think it's a fine line between doing someone, that blessing of encouraging them, but also desiring to be patted on the back.
Yeah, so you have to be careful, don't you, that we as believers, we don't fall into this rut of thinking, well, I've got to be have so many likes on Facebook,
right,
or be praised so much for doing this.
Right.
That's not the motive here. You shouldn't, it's ironic we've got lights here and the camera recording this. We don't do it to get famous, right?
No.
We don't do it for corporate sponsorship. How many folks? We don't have a whole lot of folks that watch this.
Yeah.
In the scheme of things, right? We're not a popular YouTube video or popular Facebook video by any means. That's not why we do it.
Right.
We do like folks to join in, but we do think it's worth your time. You could be watching reruns of Happy Days.
Right.
You could be watching this.
Right.
And I can promise you this is more fulfilling than a TV sitcom.
That's right. And you, as a pastor, you don't want to fall into the trap of always wanting affirmation in order to feel like you're doing something successful. Because you may be doing something very successful in the eyes of God, and before the eyes of the people, it doesn't amount to anything.
That's right, because we don't collect fruit immediately, right?
Right.
So sometimes the rewards will be noticed the other side of eternity after we've passed on. Do we ever see reap the benefits that we see that for sure? Good point there. So the last verse 3 says, did you read that one?
I didn't read verse 3.
Read verse 3.
All right. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you.
Sure, and some translations have the word openly. Right. I looked this up today, and the earliest manuscripts don't have the word openly afterwards. And as you read through the Gospel of Matthew, he will say you'll be rewarded, but the phrase openly doesn't occur again, which just, who knows, maybe a scribe placed that in there. To me, I couldn't ever reconcile why God would reward you publicly for something you did privately, unless my thought always was, if it's in the text, he means in eternity publicly, but not in this life.
Right.
I think that it's counter to what he said in the previous verses.
I agree.
So the first question up tonight, and I'm trying to read, we've got folks watching. So the first question is this: what is the danger in showiness in doing good deeds? Mm. What's the danger in that? A good deed's a good deed, but what's the danger of being showy about it?
Mm. Well, drawing attention to yourself rather than it going to Christ would be obviously one danger. And I think another danger is what we talked about, falling into the trap of needing public praise for what you're doing in the church.
Mm-hmm.
Is a danger. You end up serving the people in a bad sense instead of serving Christ faithfully.
Yeah. Become a glory hog.
Right.
Too. You try to get the glory that deserving only of God.
Right.
For the good that you've done. See, Miss Jules tuned in tonight. Miss Rita Maria's joined us some. So appreciate you guys glancing through, and please stop for a little while. I'll shout your name out. So the comment says, our Lord next warned against hypocrisy, an outward show in religious duties. What we do must be done from an inward principle, that we may be approved of God, not that we may be praised of men. In these verses, we are cautioned against hypocrisy in giving alms. So take heed of it. It's a subtle sin, and vainglory creeps into what we do before we are aware. When we take least notice of our good deeds, ourselves, God takes the most notice of them.
I think the standard of success in the Christian life is faithfulness to God. He's not going to look at numbers or anything like that. He's going to look at our faithfulness. And I think this is what this quote you just read kind of hints at, is doing it from an inward principle to serve Christ.
Yeah, the well done, the good and faithful servant.
Right.
Has nothing to do with church membership,
right.
Probably. And probably has nothing to do with the amount you gave to the church.
Right.
Has nothing to do most of the time with the deeds you've done for show.
Right.
It's the cup of cold water to someone who needed it, right?
Yeah.
It's giving someone in complete discretion, right?
Right.
A meal, buying someone gas. Right. It's helping pay for the roofing of your next door neighbor who just can't afford that. It's those things that never make it or own publicly, that never were brought before the church, that you do privately, that God rewards most, or will reward most in life to come.
Yeah, and I wonder how many of us would continue to do things in the name of Christ if we never got any notice for it.
If God called you today to scrub the toilets at a truck stop for his name, for no benefit, for no earthly benefit,
right.
How many Christians would not do that?
Right, right.
I tell you, it's there's a lot of ways we do service that are very showy, and I'm not taking away from a lot. Am I going to mention any? So I don't want to. Three or four came to mind just then. I'm not going to share any of those that we do to draw attention to ourselves. But what if it was just going to your elderly friend's house and cutting the grass or bringing groceries or things like that to a person who truly had need,
right.
Without any fanfare? Wow. So question number 2 is this, and if you're making comments, I'm going to draw attention to that. How is practicing righteousness before men a subtle sin?
Subtle sin.
It's not in your face like slander or
right.
assaulting your neighbor. So those are very obvious sins. But how is doing good a subtle sin?
Right. I think, again, it's that thin line of doing it for the right reasons, slipping over and doing that same good act for the wrong reasons.
Absolutely. Motive is very important.
Right.
Motive is very important.
Right.
I mentioned this a few weeks ago when I was doing a Mother's Day sermon on why did Eve sin. And I said, we know that Eve sinned when she ate the apple, right? And we can infer that she sinned before she ate the apple because she had the intent to do so. So we say, okay, before the sin occurs, there's the thought, right? There's right. that evil intent, which is also in itself a sin. Right. But I said, even if she avoided the apple for a good reason, it's still a sin. Like, for example, if she said, I'm not going to eat the apple, she passed by the tree 100 times and saw the apple there and said, I'm not going to eat it because it's going to ruin my diet. And if she avoided the apple for keeping her figure, right? I'm just making this up.
Right.
For the wrong reason, it was still a sin. So just doing the right thing for the wrong motives is still a wrong thing.
Right.
And that's hard to wrap our mind around, isn't it?
It is, but I'm thinking when you were talking about Jesus saying that murder is not just the physical act, it's the hatred that from within first. I mean, so there's the inclination, there's the thought before there's the action.
Mm-hmm.
That ties in with Eve's desire to, you know, it looks good, it's going to make me wise.
That's right.
Give me a bite.
So she sinned. So we know that she sinned in her mind, in her heart, before she ever took the first bite.
Right.
But what if she was not eating the fruit, but was avoiding the fruit for wrong reasons?
Right.
So that even
right.
that even brings opens up a whole other can,
right.
doesn't it?
So I'm doing good because I'm not eating the fruit, but it's the wrong motivation for not eating the fruit.
That's right.
Right.
It's not to honor God by following His command
right.
to be obedient. It's
right.
to watch my figure. And I mean, nobody gets fat eating apples, right? You never.
Of course, she didn't wear clothes then,
right?
So she was planning ahead.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So she was even thinking ahead of that. We'll continue on here. So, if you want to read the commentary on the theatrical mask.
All right. A theatrical mask from the first century BCE. Hypocrite comes from the Greek word Hippocrates, which means an actor. The word hypocrite ultimately came into English from the Greek word Hippocrates, or Hippocrates, however you would say that, which means an actor or a stage player.
So how were the Pharisees playing a part? And do you think that they... So how were they playing a part? How were the Pharisees... They were... Christ calls them hypocrites from the idea of the Greek theater. It's the
right.
mask you wore.
Right.
An actor would be on stage and he'd play this part and then he'd put a mask in front of his face and go into a different role.
Right.
You know, obviously still on the same stage.
Yep.
So a hypocrite is a mask. So how were they playing the part of a hypocrite?
Yeah, I think the Pharisees, obviously, Jesus called them whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but on the inside full of dead men's bones. So they had the facade of religion and righteousness.
Ooh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But inwardly, they were dead and corrupt. They were doing it for themselves. They weren't serving God.
Gotcha. So it come from a rotten core.
Right.
So their motives were bad, behavior was good.
Right.
See, it's important that we as Christians have orthodoxy, which is right belief,
right.
but also orthopraxy, right behavior.
Right.
So it's not enough that we do good. We have to do good for the right reasons, right?
Right?
And
exactly.
I think that the Pharisees had all kinds of, well, you could say they had some orthodoxy, but they had all kinds of orthopraxy. Christ would say, do what they do, not what they say. They tithe the month, They tithe these things into these deeds. Do what they do, but not what they say.
Right.
So they had orthopraxy down. Is that, I think I'm saying this right.
Right practice
right?
down. Orthodox, right belief, they were in the neighborhood, but they weren't quite there.
Correct, that's right. In the zip code, but they weren't doing the right motives for sure.
Right.
Do you think they want to be righteous? I mean, I think they strove to be righteous, but right for the wrong reasons.
Yeah, I mean, they were trying to earn their righteousness before God, but when the Messiah came, the very people who should have recognized who he was and should have been the first people to accept him,
yep.
they were the ones that wanted him put out of business because he was cutting in on their territory, basically.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted the kingdom for themselves.
And thought they had it, I guess, to
right.
some degree, because they had the Herodians there and
right.
in power. They didn't want Christ messing that up
right.
for sure. We're going to continue on. Thank you guys for watching here. If you want to make a comment, feel free to do so. We'll read it over the air, if we can say that. Matthew 6, 5 through 8. I'll read verse 5, and then we'll stop for the first question.
Okay.
Jesus says, and when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. That's that word again, the Greek actors, right? The mask. People wear a mask. For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Mm. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. First question, third question, first in the series here, is what reward does the hypocrite receive in this lifetime?
I'm going to say again, it's the praise of the people. That's what they're doing it for anyway. That's their reward. That's what they want. That's what they get.
They got it. I'm going to circle back and pick up part of that verse and make a comment, and then we'll let you push on with six. Sure. It says, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. And my comment says this, three times a day, a horn would sound in Jerusalem, and devout men would stop whatever they were doing and turn toward the temple. Now, if you were not in Jerusalem, you'd face Jerusalem, right? Turn toward the temple if you were in town. And the Pharisees would time their shopping so as to occur when they were in the market in order to display the righteousness. I go, it's almost noon, I got to get to the market, so when the thing sounds, I'll be the first guy to drop my bags and turn toward the temple. Now that's showy to a degree, isn't it?
Yes.
They had planned, when to show off their good deeds.
Right.
And then we'll go on to verse 6 and let you continue.
All right. Got a little comment. Get you all masks.
Get your mask. All right. Thank you, Mr. Kick. I appreciate that. Mr. Kick, you'd ask one time, and I didn't comment. Have I read the books? Well, that's a good question. Some on the bottom are reference books, so I've not read some reference, but I would say, that you can't see all the books. There's books around this way, too. But just to answer your question, most everything, two shelves up, I've read, and three shelves down here, I've read. Some of them are just the reference books, but, so, I mean, what it's worth. I just don't want to leave a thought. I've never answered that question until he reminded that.
All right. Verse 6. We ready for that?
Yes, go for it.
But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you.
Now, help me with this syllogism, Jerry, if you can do this. And you can add a comment. I mean, I just want to jump on this while I'm thinking about it. If we're to pray in our closets, Matthew 6:6, and pray without ceasing, 1 Thessalonians 5:17, then we'd always be in our closets.
Right.
Are Christians be locked in their closets perpetually? If not, then what's the essence of these verses on prayer?
We need to come out of the closet. Right?
Right, that's right. Don't just be closet Christians, right? Right. God calls us out to reveal ourselves.
Right. Obviously, the contrast between what the hypocrites are doing in their prayers publicly for the praise of people, the contrast is that the child of God goes to spend time with their Father, their Heavenly Father, to go to a place where there's no distractions. Go to a place where you're not tempted to show out for others, and pray to God, your heart, and He'll hear and reward you, answer your prayers, or whatever. And to pray constantly is, I think, you know, there are times when you go into the closet, but it's a constant state of prayerfulness. I mean, you can do a lot of things and be prayerful.
You drive a car.
Yes, with the eyes open, of course.
Right. It's not a bad idea the way some folks drive to pray while you're driving, right?
Yeah.
When you're on the roads. Yeah, so you can be a perpetual state of communicating with God, whatever you're doing.
Right.
Now, there's times you got to focus on other things, but the idea is that your heart is so close to prayer that it instantly you go right there.
And I think that's it's like breathing for a Christian. You're just kind of in a mode of prayer all the time. There's enough in life that causes you to pray. We do have a comment from Jewel Wendt. They sound a lot like Muslims.
Yeah, good point, Miss Jewel, and that's right. In Islam, they used to, a little known fact, would pray toward Jerusalem. And that's some of the older texts of the Quran. And then they changed that. I guess we found some old Quran manuscripts that would say that. And then they changed it to praying toward to Mecca. That's right. So it changed. But you're right. The idea, now this really originated not with the Jews in the first century, but it goes back to Daniel praying twice a day. And the Pharisees thought they're so much better than Daniel. They had the third prayer in the course of the middle of the day. That was their reasoning, that they can outdo Daniel. But that's it. There's nothing wrong with praying three times a day. Christ doesn't chastise them for praying three times a day. In fact, when you read the Gospel of Luke, I say the Gospel of Luke is bathed in prayer. He does nothing that he doesn't pray about it before.
Right.
Before he selects the disciples, he prays.
Right.
Before he preaches a sermon in the mountain, he prays. Before he does anything in Luke, he's always praying, which is good. Christ had a very healthy prayer life. He doesn't criticize these folks for praying. It's the way in which they prayed.
Right.
And that's what goes back to what you said earlier. It's the right behavior with the wrong motive. They were doing it for not to commune with God, but to be praised of men.
Right.
And that's never a good reason. So you agree we should pray continually, but not in our closets continually.
Right. We can come out of the closet.
Very good. So when you read these verses, the call for the Christian is to have a personal faith. Now, what's it mean to have a personal faith? Well, I think of it this way. Treat God as though he's a person, because he is a person. We're to have a personal relationship with him because God is a person. Our conversation is not to be done because we love the praise of men, but because we love intimacy with God. Yeah. When we pray to God, we're praying to a person. And I don't mean human being in that sense. I mean God possesses personality. You know what I mean by that?
Right.
He is a person. He has intellect, emotions, mind, will, all those things that make a person a person that are essential features, personality. You can sum that up. That's what it means you have a personal faith. It's not that you're going praying something from rote, not you're praying to the ceiling. You're praying to a person who hears and answers.
Just quickly, the Christian understands that. The Christian realizes quickly that we need to spend time with our Father in heaven. And we do that, obviously, in prayer and obedience and worship. But we just can't go very far in the Christian life without prayer. You look at the Pharisees, and they didn't need that time with their Father. Mm. It was all for show. And, you're talking about a depleted individual.
Oh, man.
The Pharisees must have been.
Yep. Christ even says they're their father of the devil, like in ministry, so maybe they're praying to the wrong father.
Right.
Verse 7 says, and when you pray, he's assume you're going to pray, verse 7, and so when you do pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do. So there's a couple of words I want to throw out there. So my pronunciation of Greek is really bad.
So is mine.
I mean, I can read it, but saying it aloud is really bad. Right. So I thought I'd throw a word out there. So, batalego?
Sure.
Batalego,
I guess?
Sounds
good to me.
Okay. Any Greek scholars, please slam me for that. I don't mind. So, it comes from, it's a compound word, batos, which means a proverbial stammer, and logos, which means word, someone who just stutters the same kind of word to word. That's what he says. Empty phrases can be, is that sort of thing. It's just stammering over words, right? It's babbling. It's babbling nonsense. Don't just babble nonsense.
Right.
People say, so I know it's controversy here, what I'm about to say, but, the Holy Spirit intercedes and he listens to my babbling stuff and he decodes that and somehow it's secret code. Well, Christ here speaks directly against that. Don't babble nonsense stuff.
Right.
Pray with the heart. Now, maybe there's a time you say, God, I'm at a crossroads. I don't know what to pray.
Right.
And there's nothing wrong with saying, just do what is best
right.
or help me here. But to think because you just keep adding words to it that somehow that you've done more,
right.
just there's a time to be quiet in prayer.
Yes.
To say, look, all I can say is this. I'm going to be quiet right now.
Be still and know that I am God.
Yep. And then Jesus adds the word here. He speaks, so he's going to say, don't babble or add empty phrases like the Gentiles. And there's a couple of ways it's translated. New American Standard, Gentiles. King James, heathen. And I guess international, I don't know. I forget what that was. Anyway, it's pagans. The idea is it's this group of folks who are not of the Jewish faith, not just ethnically different, but religiously different as well.
Right.
Don't be like those people who are outside of the faith. You've got a father. Your father longs to, he's a personal God. He longs to answer your prayers. And so we don't think by a waste of words he's heard you.
Right.
My prayer life is, it's like most things in my life, it's pretty concise. It's right to the point, and I say what I want to say, and I pray what I want to, and I don't mean to that God
right.
needs people to be that way, but I think I kind of get off my heart when I need to in prayer,
right.
in a matter, and I kind of leave it to rest right there.
Amen.
So question 4: how do people heap up empty phrases when they pray? Give me an example of maybe empty phrase.
Oh, empty phrases. I know where I want to go with this. But
okay.
I'm not sure I'm going to go there. Just repeating something, maybe over and over and over again. It becomes a mantra.
Yeah.
And it becomes a psychological crutch rather than you're actually pouring out your heart to God. And if you're like Samuel's mother, Hannah, I believe, prayed from her heart for a child, and the priest thought she was drunk, and he got onto her, and she said she was praying from her heart, moving her mouth, praying from her heart.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't even have to talk.
Right.
You can... the motivation of your heart. God understands that.
Yeah, he has one of those intergalactic translators, doesn't
he? Yes, he does.
And we're big Star Trek fans, as you can tell. And this time I move Kirk to you, because you're
Thank
a Kirk guy. I'm a Spock guy, so I'll switch those tonight.
Here we go.
They travel through space, and the question's always been, how did they know what the aliens said and vice versa when you get this new race? Well, in The Next Generation, they told us how that works.
Right.
It's the intergalactic translator.
That's
the
right.
same is true of God, isn't it?
Right.
Because God doesn't hear... it's not the English he's listening for, or the Hebrew, or whatever. It is the intent of the heart. You go back to Hannah, the mother, Samuel's mother, and mumbles, right?
Right.
But it's the pain of the heart, the intent of her mind is what was heard.
And God heard that.
Mm-hmm.
I think your mom says we're losing the volume from time to time.
All right. Let us, if it's a problem, let us know. We'll try to get loud and get in the microphone here. Why does Christ discourage just babbling? Why does he not want us to just to babble?
Well, he's not impressed with it, and it's empty. It means nothing. Besides, if you want to pray to God, you want to pray to God. You want to talk to God.
Yeah.
You want to spend time with God.
He knows anyway, doesn't he?
Right.
What you need before you ask. Okay, so you can pick up the second half of verse 7, for they, and
yes.
Then go through 8.
Yes. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him.
And the phrase many words, again, I don't want to bog us down with the Greek, but it's polylogia, poly many, logia words, many words. It's verbose, it's mm-hmm. just saying words. New American Standard, many words. King James Version is much speaking, with lots of words. I think when we pray publicly, you ask someone to pray, lead prayer in public, sometimes it's many words.
Right.
And there's no intent behind that because they feel like, I've got to fill this void of time.
Right.
And that can be a little irritating, but it doesn't bother me because sometimes they're just filling air time, they're filling space so others can pray. Does that
right.
make some sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. I understand that.
Like, privately, I would never pray, someone might say, like I pray publicly. I try to honestly pray publicly like I do privately, but
right.
if you don't, I understand that. Because we're trying to say, well, the pastor called me to pray, and I have to fill some time, and it's okay that I say this, and I'm okay with that. As long as the people are, you've bought them some time to pray.
Right.
I don't know if that makes sense or not. So moving on to Matthew 6:9, I'm going to read verses 9 through 13. So this is the model prayer. Okay, the Lord's Prayer is in the Gospel of John, meaning it's his prayer from the heart, where he intercedes for the disciples. It covers several chapters. This is the model, I call it the model prayer, because this is the type of how we should be praying. Pray like this then. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen. We're going to unpack the Lord's Prayer line by line and just kind of make some comments along the way and ask some questions too. So, starting off, if you want to read the first.
Pray like this. Like is a simile, which means in a similar way. It does not mean to simply repeat these words from rote memory without conscious thought of what is being said. Jesus warned his listeners, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words.
Right, so you might be a part of a congregational worship service where every service they pray the Lord's Prayer, they say the Lord's Prayer. To me, you got to be very careful that don't think that you've prayed because you've said the words.
Right.
Because you think, well, I've said all that Christ had said, and I've memorized that, right? So that's got to get me somewhere. Well, no, because in context, Christ says, pray from the heart, don't use many words, don't just do it babbling. And then he says, don't let the Gentiles when you do that. But this is kind of how, this is a template for how
right,
to pray.
Right.
That's how I look at this, as being a template.
Right.
Question 5 is, why should Christians be careful not to pray with empty words or from thoughtlessness?
Well, we've covered some of this turf, talking about motivations to pray. Again, you don't want to be like an unbeliever who thinks that whatever God they're praying to is going to be impressed by how many words they can say or how much theology they might know when they're praying or trying to figure God out while you pray. Don't pray with empty words. Empty words are thoughtless words. There's no heart, there's no thought, there's no reason for you to be praying if it's empty.
Yeah, right. While you wouldn't have a conversation with somebody on the street,
yeah.
Walk up to him, red balloon, zebra, giraffe, monkey face, automatic transmission, right? So why would you
right.
do that to God? Why do you think that God would like, oh, I'm glad that you just spent time with me?
Yeah, I think we try to impress God sometimes when we pray.
Right, as though he can be impressed.
Right.
Now let's continue. We're going to go line by line through the prayer. Our Father, of course, there's a common kinship of believers with God.
Mm.
There's different metaphors describing our relationship with God. It doesn't describe a physical relationship.
Right.
God didn't become a father at some point in time. It's only a distinction that we as people have, God has revealed to us to understand how he and the Son get together. But it's not a physical,
right.
It doesn't describe a physical sonship and fathership that they have together. So we borrow that, right? We're not God the Son, but we're allowed to call him Father. It's a metaphor.
Right.
It describes a relationship of he is our superior, we give him reverence, that sort of thing. Right. And then I'll take the next before I let you go, the next one. So hallowed be your name. Of course, hallowed means holy. We celebrate Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not religiously.
Right.
That's fun, right? Een is evening before, and hallow is holy, right?
Holy.
All Holy's Day is November 1. All Saints Day, right?
Right.
And so the evening before, but I'm just, and so hallow, we don't use the word hallow very often,
right.
But that's the idea.
Holiday's another thing.
Oh, yeah.
That's a holy day. That's what that means.
Yeah, it's just been sort of smashed, hasn't it? The word holy day to holiday.
Right.
So we're to go to God, who is our Father, intimate, but also held in reverence.
Right.
He's not just God. He's not just the old man upstairs.
Right.
He's not Santa Claus. He's not that. He's also holy. Holy be your name.
Mm-hmm.
Now, God's name is not Father, but he did reveal his name at the burning bush. It's Yahweh, right? So use that reverently. So we hold him in reverence.
Right.
So if Father stresses our relationship with the divine, we've got a relationship with him, then holy emphasizes the distinctiveness between us and him. We're not God, and he is.
Right. So again, he's not going to be impressed with our heaping up of empty words.
Right. He doesn't need to hear that, man, for sure. We'll go on to the next.
All right, your kingdom come. The kingdom of God is that moral and spiritual kingdom which the God of grace is setting up in this fallen world. It also looks forward to the consummation of history. So we're praying for God's kingdom to come. We're praying for its consummation. We're praying for its growth and its consummation.
Yeah. There's a sense in which the kingdom is already here,
right,
which was inaugurated in Christ's ministry, right? Unless you can't plunder the strong man's house unless you bind him first.
Right
in the context of demonic exorcism. He bound Satan, limited his force of control, and established the kingdom on the earth.
Right.
And there's a sense in which we Christians, ambassadors of that kingdom.
Correct.
It's in a sense here, in a sense not here to some degree.
Yeah.
Well, the ancient Jews said, he prays not at all, in whose prayers there's no mention of the kingdom of God. Hence, they were accustomed to say, let him cause his kingdom to reign and his redemption to flourish, and let the Messiah speedily come and deliver his people. So the Jews were, in this day and age, among the rabbis, were fond of saying, you've not prayed lest you pray for the coming kingdom.
Hmm.
And I think this is neat. In the Gospel of John, John chapter 1, in fact, Philip goes to get Andrew, and Andrew is underneath a tree, fig tree. And it was customary for the Jews in the noonday to pray under a tree, under the shade of a tree, right? And what does Philip say when he comes to get Andrew? We found the Messiah, the one we've been seeking for. And what is so cool is he's praying for the one that has already come, and his buddy's come and tell him, I found the Messiah. You've been praying for this guy? Come and see the Messiah. That's how he introduces him. And then, of course, Jesus says, and I saw you when you're praying under the fig tree. And all of a sudden, this is the Messiah. So that's the idea. A devout Jew would have been praying and still be praying for the coming kingdom. We realize there's a sense in which the kingdom has come when the king arrived, and we found the king.
Right. And I think that's what we want. We want God's kingdom to come. We were saved out of the kingdom of the earth, entered into the kingdom of God. That's our home. And that's what we should want.
So we're told in the model prayer to pray, your kingdom come. You realize your kingdom on this earth as we're working it out.
Right.
The next one is your will be done. So it's the transformation of the earth, the perfect will of God. It's living on this earth as Christ would have us to. Don't make the mistake in thinking that the Sermon on the Mount is not for us, that it's for another dispensation or the kingdom, the millennial time. It's for us.
It's
to be living this out. Turn the other cheek, as we saw last week, you know. Don't harbor hatred. And this prayer is not something that we're to save for 1,000 years or during a millennial reign.
Right.
Do it right now.
Right now. Our daily bread. The word epiusian, daily bread, has greatly perplexed critics and commentators. It was first used in the Gospels. It calls attention to the manna in the wilderness of Israel's wandering.
Right. So you remember the story. They were out in the wilderness, and they began to get hungry, and God said, I'm going to give you food, this manna. And in fact, manna means what is it?
What is it?
It's
right.
The what is it. It's like bread. It's sticky. It's sweet like honey. It doesn't last long. you were to collect only that morning what you could eat that day, and the day before the Sabbath, you could get 2 days' worth, so you wouldn't work on the Sabbath. It wouldn't come on the Sabbath. Right? And it wouldn't go bad. But if you got more than you needed, it would go bad. If you didn't get enough, it seemed to last you anyway.
Right.
I like to have some of that what is it, wouldn't you?
Yeah, what is it? I want some.
Maybe it was angel food cake. Who knows what it was.
There you go.
So that's one idea. So this is like, it's like the man in the wilderness. God fed them each day. But there's two more interpretations to this. One was the idea is that the woman who went in the marketplace to shop would buy for her daily needs that day, would buy just what she would need to cook that day. Because that was before refrigeration, right? So you couldn't buy a lot of things ahead of time. The market would be there the next day. Buy what you need that day. And then the second one, and I like this other explanation, is there was if you were a slave, and at this point in time, roughly half the population were in slavery one way or the other, right? So half the population roughly was a slave at this point of history. If you were the master, you'd send your servant or slave out to the field to work, and you gave him just enough for that day, so he didn't run off,
right?
And have 3 days eaten, right? Or if you sent him off on an errand, a two-day journey, you gave him 2 days, but you gave him his daily bread.
Right.
So whichever one you think, the man in the wilderness, Israelite wandering, the woman going to the store to buy food, buying it that day, or the slave who was given just enough rations to eat and then come back that evening, I like them all. I think most closely it's the man in the wilderness. I think it's the manna reference, but I like them both because they're both in the context of first century. They both were true.
Praying for God to supply our needs daily.
Yeah, that's right. It's kind of redundant. Pray daily for daily bread. He didn't say wonder bread, right?
No wonder bread.
He doesn't say pray for the wonder bread truck to stop in your driveway and have a month's worth of food. It's daily provisions. It's rations to get you through, isn't it?
Trusting God day by day.
We want a 5-year plan, and God says, "I'm going to give you today what you need."
And it creates the proper attitude for us as Christians, which is to depend upon God to take care of us.
Yep. Dependence. Very good. I want to just take a second here and contrast and compare Luke and Matthew, this point of the Lord's Prayer, and notice how they're different, and we're going to see how they're also really going to be the same. If you want to read Luke 11:4.
Luke 11:4. Jesus says, "And forgive us our sins." The Greek word for sin is hamartia. It is a departure from doing what is right, equivalent to sin, wrongdoing.
So we know what sin is. It's doing bad things.
Right.
Forgive us of the bad stuff we've done.
Right.
Matthew does not use that in the wording of his Lord's Prayer. But I think they're going to be the same in essence what we're after here. He says, "Forgive us our debts." Epihelamata. I'm butchering that.
Glad you got that one instead of me.
Should have. It's a coin toss. And it's not a sin. It is a debt that is owed. Forgive us of our debts. Now, he's not saying go get an extra line of credit at the hardware store and then pray that God somehow wipes it off the guy's computer, his booking system. Nope. It's not what that's about. It's the same concept. So forgive us our debts.
Right. Sin is represented here under the notion of a debt. And as our sins are many, they are called here debts. Man has nothing to pay. The debt must be forgiven.
Amen.
So the word debt is actually fleshing out something about the sin itself.
Right. It's a nuanced idea. We know what sins are, but Matthew gives us, well, you think of sin this way. Every time you commit an infraction, you owe God the fee for that.
Right.
It's a monetary fee, right? Here's the punishment for a parking ticket, a speeding ticket. There's a payment that is due because you have put this on the account, right? You're racking up debts every time that you sin. And there comes a point where you stop and say, "I will never." There's a mountain of parking tickets and speeding tickets. I'll never be able to pay this off. There's so many infractions. I've accumulated this debt that is beyond my imagination. God, you've got to forgive this debt, you know.
Right.
And that's exactly where he's driving you to.
Right.
Forgive us of all the wrong forgive me all the wrong on my account today.
Right. Even if it was just one sin, we couldn't even pay that.
Yeah,
theologically speaking, we couldn't pay God.
Yeah, that's why Paul will say later, "For by grace we are saved through faith." That's not, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest a man should boast.
Right.
Even your being forgiven is not a works thing that you've done to earn.
Right.
It is a gift of God. You've been forgiven not because you've worked toward it, because God didn't owe it to you.
Right.
Because he freely gives it to you.
Amen. Lead us not into temptation. Bring us not into sore trial. Keep us from evil.
Very good. So Paul will tell us to pray this in 1 Corinthians, right? There's no temptation taking you but such as common to man, but God who's faithful will with the temptation make your way escape so you can bear it. It's okay to say, this temptation's crushing me, I can't resist, get me out of here, or even don't lead me down that path.
Right.
God's not leading you to temptation anyway, but you can pray, hey God, help me to not go places where I would be tempted.
That's right. That's right. Again, it's depending upon God to help, not just supply your daily bread, but to help you in your sanctification.
Absolutely. But deliver us from evil, so parallel with not being led to temptation or trial. So it's kind of the same sort of, keep me, don't let me go there, but if I get there, get me out of there quickly.
Right.
Don't leave me there, but if I'm in there, deliver me out of it.
Right.
So question 6, why does the model prayer contain these petitions?
These are the things that we should set our mind on when we're praying. Thoughtful of God as our Father, but also as God. And you go down the line of things that Jesus mentioned here. Praying for the kingdom to come, for his will to be done.
Recognize his Father, he's holy.
Right. So you don't go to, like you said, to the big guy upstairs and say, God, this is how it is.
Not right.
This is what I want. This is what I want to do. Make it happen.
Right, that's right. Even when you ask of God, it should be reasonable ask.
Right.
It should be an ask that is a reasonable, that in the sense that it's not over what you would need, right?
Right.
It's daily bread. It's not, I might need a car, but I don't have to have the newest Cadillac in the driveway.
Right.
Now, God could allow you to have a Cadillac. There's nothing wrong with owning a Cadillac, not by any means. If you guys have an extra one, send me a Cadillac. but don't think that I'm going to ask over and above because God wants to pour out all these things. I think you've asked with the wrong heart. It's
right.
A wrong ask to ask that way.
The Lord's Prayer keeps us in the proper boundary of how we should pray. And what we should pray for.
Amen. We'll move on here. Verse 14 through 15. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Verse 15. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses.
Mm. Forgiven people forgive people. This is not a works-based system of salvation, but a demonstration that a person has been forgiven by his ability to forgive others.
Yeah.
This is a hard.
Because it seems on the surface that you're earning salvation by your ability to forgive others, but this can't be true, because you can never forgive to the degree necessary to save yourself.
Right.
You can't forgive enough to be forgiven enough.
Right.
So, I mean, it's one of those things where Jesus is saying something that's kind of in your face.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know, the beam in your eye and the speck in your neighbor's eye. It's hyperbole. It's one of those kinds of phrasings that's to shock you,
right?
To show how important it is. It's important to forgive others. It is very important. It's like your salvation is contingent upon it. That's how important that it is.
Right, right. Good point. Good point. Fasting in Matthew 6:16-18. And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward.
So it's implied that you will fast. I don't fast. I fast between meals consistently.
Yeah.
But I don't fast away meals for sure. But it's implied that you would fast.
Right. Right. I choose not to preach on this text.
That's right. There's certain texts. Right. It's kind of like this church, you call this young pastor, and he was really on fire. And the first Sunday he preached against a congregational sin. And I don't know, maybe it was smoking or something. And the guy pulled him and said, look, you know, this is West Kentucky. They grow tobacco here. Don't preach so hard on tobacco because people depend upon this. Okay, I won't. So then the next week he preached really hard on temperance and how he shouldn't be drinking. And he said, look, I want you to know again, you know, so we got some folks here that might take a little alcohol. And so don't preach so hard on that, right? It's like he's discouraged. The wind is out of his sails because his last two fiery sermons have been really criticized by someone in the church. So finally, the third Sunday, he decided to preach against the evils of fishing in international waters without a license. So make sure he stepped on nobody's toes. I'll butcher that joke a little bit. But the point is, if we're going to fast, and there's no reason why we shouldn't fast, again, it's not a showy kind of a thing. Nobody should know that you're fasting.
Right.
If you go to work and say, wow, I'm fasting today. I got to really get through. Pray for me.
Right.
You just lost it, didn't you?
You just lost it right there.
Now, I'll share something quickly before I move on. Fasting was required one time a year on the Day of Atonement. It was a required fast. The only required fast. But the Pharisees fasted mandatory twice a week. So they said, well, God wants you to fast once a year. We're going to fast two times a week.
We'll up you one.
Right. In this case, 100. Right. 100 weeks of fastings. Whatever. 100 times of fasting. So what reward does the hypocrite receive from fasting?
Praise of people.
Yeah. Oh, you're fasting? You must be a really devout Christian. Right. If somebody knows you're fasting, there's a problem. You should be fasting more.
Right.
You should be more serious in your faith if everybody knows you're fasting.
Right. Comb your hair.
Right. That's right. Verse 17.
But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. So, do you want the praise of people, or do you want the reward of God?
Yeah, very good. Well, it's been purported that the Pharisees would cover their faces in dirt so as to look haggled, dirty, and exhausted and tired when he fasted. This magnified the appearance of real suffering. So, I'm not just going to fast. I'm going to let everybody know that I'm fasting.
Right.
And then if you want to do a little...
Yes. A hypocrite has always a difficult part to act. When he wishes to appear as a penitent, not having any godly sorrow at heart, he is obliged to counterfeit it the best way he can, by a gloomy and austere look.
Mm. Yes, the fake sadness.
Right. It's the preacher that cries on cue during the sermon.
Oh, man.
Every time.
And we've seen those before, right?
Yeah.
As though he's moved by an unseen force.
Right.
And then the cameras stop rolling and it's done.
It's done.
Treasures in heaven. We're getting close to the end of this. I appreciate you guys sticking this out. We're now in verse 19 and it goes a little bit faster this point forward. Matthew 6, 19 to 24. I'll start with verse 19 and pause and then go on.
All right.
Matthew 6, 19. Do not lay up treasures for yourselves on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. And I'll make a quick comment here. There are three types of treasures in the ancient world: clothes, food, and precious metals. Now, Christ will show that each of these diminish in value. The moth eats your clothes.
Mm.
Now, the word rust is brosis, is the Greek word, and it really means rot. It's better applied to mean rot. While metals do rust, it's the idea of rotting, a rotting food.
Okay.
Don't store up warehouses, grain storages, right, where it's just going to rot anyway. Like the man who, you know, the parable that Christ told to the guy, I'll tear down my barns and build bigger barns. And then, of course, the precious metals are stolen by thieves. So he says, if you're depending upon excess clothes, excess food, excess precious metals, they're all subject to being lost, eaten up, or stolen.
But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, verse 20 says, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
That's right. And he goes back to that moth, rot, and thieves, the things that can take your treasures. If something can take your treasure, it wasn't a heavenly treasure to start with. So the danger in possessing possessions, your possessions can possess you.
Right.
And I won't say that fast five times.
No.
So the next question is, how does one invest in the bank of heaven?
Mm-hmm. It's a good question. And obviously there's some answers from what we've looked at tonight. Living for Christ, doing what Christ asks you to do, whether it's praying in a way that is in accordance to the model prayer, or serving Christ faithfully, whether anybody's watching or not, doing acts of obedience from a glad and happy heart. I think these things, you know, lack of a better way to say it, bring the smile of God upon you.
That's right. And they're direct deposited.
Yes.
And nobody breaks into heaven and steals stuff from your heavenly account.
Because they're not supposed to know you've got all this heavenly treasure anyway.
Right. There's no bank statement that you bring out before your friends, right? That's a good point. Question 22. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light.
Mm.
But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? And I'll make a quick comment before we go on. The eye brings light into the body, like a lamp would. So with the spiritual eye, you let in spiritual truth. Spiritual truth is to be understood with the spiritual eye, to be seen. So the eye is a lamp of the body. It's not that you're emitting light outside of your eyes. You're not projecting light. Eyes don't project light. They take light in. It lightens the inside of your body. So the spiritual eye, whether the eye of understanding, being able to open your eyes and see the truth, lightens your body, lightens your spirit, soulish part of man.
Right. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money.
Very good. And I read something today, and I thought this just kind of blew my socks off. That Mammonas is a Chaldean word. It's a name of a Syrian and Chaldean god. You can't serve the true God of scriptures and the Chaldean god of avarice, greed. So Mammonas was the god of greed, a god of avarice.
And of course, King James had Mammon in there.
So you can't serve God, the one true God you ought to be serving, and this other god.
Right.
See how greed becomes an idol?
Right.
How Mammon itself becomes an idol which you worship? Christ is making a very clear distinction here. If you're serving Mammon, you're not serving God. The rich young ruler comes to Christ, and Christ gives him this impossible thing to do. Don't break the commands, right? Honor God, whatever. Honor your neighbors. The guy's like, I've done all these things. Haven't disrespected my mother. Haven't, lied. That was his first lie, right? It wasn't his first lie, but he lied there.
Right.
Stolen, all these kinds of things, right? And then Christ says, okay, well then, sell all you have, give it to the poor, and follow me. The Bible says he walked away sad because he had great possessions. You see, he was worshiping the wrong God.
Right.
He was worshiping Mammon. He was not by name, not that he had an idol built in his home, but in principle, in spirit, he was worshiping the god avarice of greed. He was worshiping something else. And that's what that Christ is like. You can't worship two gods. You can't set the fence.
Right.
Our God's a jealous God. You got to serve him. But if you want to serve avarice, go at it. But don't think you're going to switch uniforms and play for this team at some point.
Exactly.
At your discretion. The next is about worry. We're going to wrap up with worry.
Matthew 6, 25 through 34. Verse 25 says, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they?
Mm-hmm. Now, let me pause here, and I'll make a note of this. I just want you, for those watching at home, so I want you to see this pattern as we go through from this point forward. There are three types of possessions, or three categories of wealth in the first century. Food, excess food, as a big deal in the first century. If you had storehouses of food, you're doing good. Clothes, if you had extra clothes, you're doing really, really good for yourself, right? And then precious metals. I want you to notice that Christ will address the first two, food and clothing, and leave off the metals about what people worry about. He's going to prioritize. He's going to use Maslow's hierarchy of needs. He's starting at the bottom of the pyramid here. Food and shelter, because clothing is a form of shelter.
You're
covering yourself. These two basic things, food and shelter. He's going to leave completely off the precious metals, gold, that kind of a treasure, and you're going to see why. So I'm going to move on to this.
All right. Where do we leave off?
27, maybe.
All right. And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass in the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? O, you of little faith. Therefore,
I just pause just for a second.
Yes, yes.
So through those four verses, 27, 8, 27, 28, 29, again, he's touching upon clothing and food.
Right.
Even though he just mentioned the wealthiest king in Israel's history had tons of gold, he doesn't mention Solomon's gold. It's only, his clothes.
Right. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble.
Very good. I'm just not getting that. So, quick comment here. Of the three types of wealth I mentioned, that I hope you guys are picking up on this, Jesus only addresses two of those, essential for survival, food and shelter, food and clothing. In the animal kingdom, there's no use for precious metals. Lilies of the field, clothed. Birds of the air, fed. But you've never seen a bird go around wearing a nice gold necklace, right?
Right.
You've never seen the nice flowers that's probably in the springtime adorned in jewelry. Precious metals aren't making the list of necessary things. So Christ says, we worry about the things you need for survival. But God takes care of the animals' needs. How much more does he care about you and the needs that you have?
Right.
Not that gold or precious metals are bad in themselves, but you don't need that to survive, right?
Right.
Would you rather have a bar of gold or a jug of water? Well, it depends where you are.
Right.
If you're in the middle of a desert, that bar of gold doesn't do you much good to the jug of water you want.
That's right.
Well, why is it important to not worry about material possessions?
Well, number one is what you said. They don't contribute to covering your body, protecting your body, sheltering your body. And certainly, you can't eat it. God will supply the food and the clothing.
We seem to, generally speaking, get that need met. We tend to get food and shelter. We tend to get that. A lot of charitable organizations feed and clothe people, for sure. Not many pass out bars of gold.
No. Of course, somebody, I can hear somebody saying, well, don't you need the precious metals to buy the food and to buy the clothes?
Yeah, so currency, obviously, is a means to get those things. And there's nothing wrong with currency. It's not money, as Paul would say, it's the love of money, which is where things get off the track there. Being anxious, Christ would say, you know, if you're worrying, you're not praying. If you're praying, you're not worrying. He has ordained this universe to reward those who work, right? And sometimes even those who don't.
Yeah.
Because even the birds get fed and the flowers get clothes of the bloom.
Right.
So Christ is like, don't worry about those things. They take care of themselves. You seek after God and his righteousness, and everything else falls into place.
The priority is the kingdom of God, not amassing precious metals, right?
Absolutely.
So, by the way, the birds get up at like 4 in the morning to get that free food.
No, that's right. It's not so free. There's a lot of work involved with getting those worms, isn't it?
God will provide. Jewel went.
Amen. Thank you, Miss Jewel. Appreciate you saying that. Close out with a little song and then a prayer, and we'll finish up. Thank you for tuning in tonight.
Yes.
In about an hour, we're going to try to get out of here on time at 7:02. We start a couple minutes afterwards. So after this 2-minute song, morning prayer. This song stresses how important it is to start your day with prayer.
We wanted to give you this morning, Lord. We wanted to give you this day. Thanks for the sun and his light in our hearts. There are so many things we need to say. As we look to a new day to spend, it's exciting to think what it means that you would choose us and use us and call us your own, that you love us and give us a new song to sing. In order to give you the whole of the day, we must give you this very special part. The sun as it rises reminds us of you. A day without you, thank you.
Very good. How important it is to pray. And Christ gave us a perfect model of how we should be praying. Thanks for watching this night. Appreciate that, guys. Those from Salem Baptist Church joining us. If you didn't catch it tonight and live, I will put the copy on YouTube and post it to my wall, my page, and also Jerry's page as well. So you guys can watch it anytime. Be archived there. Be mindful of those folks that are still delivering food. We have a lady in the church who runs Hopkins County school buses, and she's delivering food, so keep those folks in prayer. They're going to be extending the food programs in Hopkins County for those kids through June 30th. If you don't know how to get in touch with them, call the board office, and they'll make sure if you've got kids that, or know of kids in the neighborhood that don't have an access to the food program, if you're a student in Hopkins County, you qualify, and they get you that food. So pray for the folks who are working through this summer doing those programs. Anything pressing you guys think about in your church that's needed for prayer?
Just a few folks that have some health issues. We want to keep them in our prayers and just pray about when we get back in church.
Amen. We pray and pray speedily.
Speedily.
Can close us out in prayer, Brother Jerry?
Yes, let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you, Father, for our time together in your word tonight. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that enlivens the truth to our minds and hearts. Help us to live out what we've learned tonight. And thank you, Lord, for the technology that enables us to come together through the internet to worship and glorify your name. Thank you, God, for supplying all of our needs from your rich and vast storehouse in heaven. And we ask it in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.
Remind you guys, Sunday morning, 10 o'clock Sunday school worship at the church, 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock Sunday school, 11 o'clock worship. Or if you're in the Morton's Gap area, please, Salem Baptist Church, love to have you. 10 o'clock for worship.
10 o'clock.
It's still outside.
Outside.
And hopefully it's still cool enough at 10 that it's a comfortable
right.
experience.
Right.
See you guys here, there, and everywhere. Take care. I got to go shut this off here, Jerry.
All right, brother.